It is 7 o'clock in the Netherlands from the And the Groove Remains production team studios in the Netherlands. My name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this Ask Me Anything live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, my mission is to educate and teach you about collection management and conversion for DJs so you save yourself more time for the fun and creative part of being a DJ. For this Ask Me Anything, I have a lot of questions already sent in through the comments from last stream and through Facebook. So thank you for that, for all those questions, guys, because that gives me material to keep this stream going. As some of you know, I give away the very famous And the Groove Remains production team final cup coasters. Those are these things and you can use them like these. These are to put your glass on. And last week's question of the week, or person of the week who commented on the stream, is Mario G. Mario G actually had a whole slate of questions, but they are all related to each other. So I get into that later on the stream. If you got questions during this stream about things that are not clear, or you have a very new question, ask them in the chat. Yvette is moderating the chat, and if something comes up, she will give a signal to me when the time is right within the stream and we get into the questions. So keep those questions coming, guys. If you watch this stream later, thank you and keep watching it. Some housekeeping things. On June the 2nd, I will have my friend and co-host Jeroen Groenendijk of Pioneer DJ. He's the product specialist over there, Pioneer DJ Europe, over to answer some Racket Box specific questions. So if you've got things you want to know about a Racket Box and you was always afraid to ask, ask them in the comments of this stream and I make sure that I stack them all for when Jeroen is with me and we have a lot of questions for Jeroen, which makes life a lot easier for him as well. Okay, today's questions are, like I said, all a little bit intertwined. They are all related to each other. So let's head to the screen and let's start with answering those questions. Always happy if this works. The first question was someone who had a Serato collection, and within that Serato collection, Serato reported some tracks as corrupt. That's the exclamation mark in Serato, if I'm not mistaken. And that thing can mean two things, actually. Or it's actually the lightning flash in Serato that indicates a track is damaged. But this damage can be on two levels. It can mean that the specific Serato tags within the track are damaged, which means Serato has a hard time getting the cues, the grid and the loops out of the track. Or it can mean that the MP3 track is damaged in general, and that means basically that it's worthless. And this person asked me, Mixmaster G, does Racket Box has a similar method? Well, in Racket Box things are a little bit easier because Racket Box doesn't care about any tags. Only thing Racket Box cares about is the audio stream within the file. And if it can read the audio in the file, then it's fine with it. So there is no exclamation mark in Racket Box. Rule of thumb, if Racket Box analyzes a track, so you see the analyzation web form with the cues on it, then you know you're good to go. One thing I want to mention as well is a little program called Faking the Funk. It's multi-platform. It does not run on Catalina. It does not run on Catalina. Let me warn you again, Faking the Funk does not work on Catalina. I'm on a Mojave machine, as most of you know. Let me show you what Faking the Funk does. First of all, I love the name. I love the name, I love the icon. So that already is a plus for me. But Faking the Funk will analyze tracks you throw at it, and then it will tell you if that track is actually 320 BPS, KBS, or that it's something else, like a lower bit rate, which can influence the quality of the audio of that particular track. What you do is you just give it a folder with tracks or your complete track collection, and it will analyze all those tracks and it will report which tracks are damaged, and that's for the questionnaire. The answer if you want to be sure, use Faking the Funk. And it also will tell you which tracks pose themselves as a 320 kilobit track, but are in truth something else. And that again will influence the sound quality of that track. So Faking the Funk, just something I want to give you a heads up about, that can detect those corrupt tracks. Another question I had was, let me quit Faking the Funk, but because it's basically a Windows app, it's always hard to quit it. The other question I had was about iTunes and Rekordbox, because you always see me using iTunes, and again, here is iTunes. Remember, set your advanced preferences correct. These are your preferences as they should be, with your iTunes library checked in it. For the rest, I don't care about what you do, but keep those advanced preferences as I just showed you. Here we've got a little demo collection in iTunes, and this questionnaire had the question, how do you use that in Rekordbox? And that's very simple, because Rekordbox is already built for that. Rekordbox has what is called the Sync Manager, and you see it in the lower left corner of the screen. My mouse is already parked there, and if I click it, you get a dialog box and asks me, do you want to sync with iTunes? Yes, I do. Now first let me show you what happens if you don't sync with iTunes live. Then you get this. Everything is empty there. You see there is nothing in the iTunes tab of Rekordbox. Second of all, because I forget that, go to the view and make sure that you have the iTunes tab enabled, because otherwise you don't have an iTunes bridge there in the overview. So you have to need to have that enabled. Then you go to the Sync Manager. Let me give you another heads up, which is useful to use under analysis. Enable the auto analysis. If you have watched my workflow video, which I recorded yesterday, I was just working in the studio, I had some time on my mind. I had a lot of new tracks that needed to be added to my various collections. So I thought, why not I just stream what I'm doing so you guys get an idea how this works in the real life situation. And there you can see I use this exact what I'm going to show you now, iTunes to Rekordbox. And for that, I always have the BPM grid enabled, because I always import my tracks from the XML bridge, the converted tracks from Traktor in my case, after the tracks are already in the Rekordbox collection through the iTunes bridge. So the iTunes bridge always comes first, and then the importing of converted data. And that's why the BPM grid is enabled. And I enable auto analysis. Now, why do I do that? The moment I'm going to tell Sync Manager to sync with iTunes, and then you can always pick which crates you will. But basically what I always do, because my playlists in iTunes are tidy. iTunes is my collection manager, so it is tidy. Everything there needs to be in Rekordbox as it is. So I just click the all playlists, and that will take care of everything in iTunes synced to Rekordbox. And if you look at the lower left corner right here at my mouse, you see that Rekordbox automatically started to analyze, and you see the WAV forms appear. So that's the reason why I have auto analysis enabled for my iTunes workflow, for my real workflow. But there are situations where you don't want to have auto analysis, or at least not the BPM grid, because you want to have that information from converted tracks. It's just a matter of preference. It's just a matter of how you work. But the Sync Manager is your friend, and you can see right now that you've got those little recycle icons in the playlists, and that indicates these are synced. Another thing I want to warn about, which scared the living Jesus out of me, there are situations where you look inside the iTunes part of Rekordbox and you see your playlists and there are no tracks. They are empty. If that occurs, go to the Sync Manager, disable the iTunes sync completely, quit Rekordbox like this, start up Rekordbox again, so basically restart Rekordbox. Go to the Sync Manager and make sure that the sync is enabled again. Click the gray button and you should be safe. that's just a little something I had seen myself, and I've seen on Reddit several questions about it. So you know how to fix it now. Just basically switch on and off the sync manager and you'll be good. Then we go to the next part, and that is sharing a record box and or an iTunes collection with other computers, and especially Windows computers. And for that I developed the collection backup tool, but first let me tell you how you can manually backup everything in a record box if you want to do that. If you hold the Alt key, the Option key on the keyboard, and you go in the Finder to Go, you see that the library becomes available. If you don't press the Option key, it's not there. You need to press the Option key, and then you go to Library. And you see me doing this several times during my workflow sessions and during my streams, because I switch collections a lot. Everything Pioneer related is stored in this folder, Pioneer. And if you look into there, you can see that there is a lot of stuff there. But basically everything you need to know, all your playlists, all your tracks with cues, etc., are in that folder. Now, this is a small demo collection, so I can just drag it to a safe location, I'll be done. My real life collection, that Pioneer folder, is huge. It got scattered files, it got a lot of stuff in there. So there is no way I just want to drag and drop it to a drive, because that will take ages to copy over. For that I use Carbon Copy Cloner, and let me show you how you can use that on yourself. Fire up. By the way, this is only the metadata, folks, so only the playlist, cues, etc. These are not the tracks. This is just a backup of your metadata. Let me take a free one like this, and we can say we want Pioneer to be the source, and I can say I want the Prutz drive to be my destination, why not? And I can basically say clone, run now. And like I said, this is very small, so this is very quick. And then I've got the Pioneer folder, actually the subfolder of the Pioneer folder. Let me do that correct for you then. It is not that confusing, like this. And there we go. And if we open this one, you see the record box folder is at the root. And if we look here, the record box folder is at the root. And if disaster strikes, I can just copy this back to my library. Again, this is the user level library. This is the library you go to if you press the Alt key and you go to Library. Other way to go, which is also very safe to do, is in the Go menu, say go to folder, and then type exactly what I type here. And it doesn't matter if you're on a foreign system, if you're on a Spanish and Italian, and it doesn't matter. If you type this, so the little tile and then /library/, you get into the library, and there you see the Pioneer. So those are various things to make a backup of your Pioneer data. When Jeroen is coming over June the 2nd, don't forget it, mark it in your agenda. I will ask him how RecordBox 6 works with backups, and I will ask him how you can do this with tracks, because RecordBox 6 is lacking the RecordBox XML export, and that is something I'm going to need for the rest of my demonstration. What am I going to do? You saw there was already an iTunes collection right here, and you saw we now have a RecordBox collection. And let's go back to that RecordBox collection and pick up a random track to give it some cues. Just a random track. As you can see, there are no playlists in my RecordBox collection. They exist though on the iTunes level. Let's go into the trance thing and let's pick, why not, All I Need by Air. We load it up and we just give it a random cue. Give it a cue here. And let's give it a little loop there. Like here. Why I'm doing this is just to have some data there, because we started out with an empty collection, as you could see, and now I gave it some data. So basically, the air track is our reference track, is our focus track, and it got now a loop and it got a cue. And if I load it up again, indeed, we got those two. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to store this, of course, as a Rekordbox XML. And then replace the existing one there. That's what I need to do in Rekordbox. And again, folks, you cannot do this in Rekordbox 6. Only Rekordbox 5 has this capability. I'm still in negotiation with PinyDJ what we can do about it. They are willing to help me, but they are short on resources. They need programmers and a team to do that. And they need to have a political to make a political decision. Do they want it back? So there are some things in motion there, but it's still unclear how it's going to end. So keep that in mind. We are talking to each other. They are trying to help, but we have to see where it's going to land. I can leave a Rekordbox. And for now, I'm going to use the collection backup tool. But before I do that, I'm going to format my Prutz drive. And as I keep saying every week, make it an XFAT drive and make it master boot record. Like this. Which means Prutz is empty. As you can see right here, I keep Prutz open. So you get an idea of what's going on here. The first step I'm going to take is I'm going to start up the collection backup tool. And I'm going to point it to my Rekordbox collection. And that is right here. Let's see what we can do. There. And usually I use the collection backup tool together with the Denon Converse utility. Not for now. I'm just using it as the collection backup tool, which is as a standalone, and we take the Prutz drive as our destination drive. What the collection backup tool will do is it will take all the tracks that are part of that Rekordbox collection you just saw, which doesn't have any playlists, mind you, and basically import it. And it just has done that. So we have here the tracks. One of the nice things of the Rekordbox backup tool is that it keeps your storage structure. So people who are used to have it in crates like this, this is still your same storage structure. It doesn't make a mess out of folders with album cover names and I don't know what. It keeps your storage structure. It just moves it all to the right side. And then it creates a Rekordbox XML, which contains the data for the file stored on Prutz. What does this mean? This means that if I'm blanking out my Rekordbox collection, and let me do that. Again, I go to the library, the user level library, and I just simply this one, and I do this, and that means my Pioneer, my Rekordbox collection is empty again. The Pioneer empty zip is just a Pioneer folder with all the settings I want to have as I want to have them, and then I zipped it before I added tracks. So basically it's really an empty collection, but with all the settings there, and that's why I keep using that one. If we look at the collection, you can see zero tracks, which is exactly as expected. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to point my preferences to the Rekordbox XML on the Prutz drive. Like this. Now, if I'm going to import that information in the Rekordbox XML, in Rekordbox, I still will not have any playlists because there was no playlist information in Rekordbox. That is all in iTunes, right? So, like this, import the stuff. Mind you, you can only do this with Rekordbox 5.6.0 reliably, but most of you know that by now. So we go have a look at the collection and it didn't find any tracks. And I wonder why that is. Because they are all here and they don't have playlists. You know what? We know the track which has all the information because that's Air. So we can load that up straight from here. Let me find that for you. There it is. Drop it in. And there you see our track with the cues and the loops. You see that? This track is on the Prutz drive. If I'm going to ask information, show in the Finder. And you can see right here, if you look at where, you see it's on Prutz. It's no longer on my system, it's on Prutz. The moment I disconnect Prutz, it will be gone. Which is one of the good things you can use in this situation, because if you want to prepare a CDJ USB with one of your buddies and you want to have access to your entire record box collection, then this is the way to do that. Now remember, I want to have my playlists, and if I look at iTunes right now and I go to the Air track in iTunes, that one is still pointing to my original collection, the one I deleted, remember? So if I load Air from here, it will not have any cues, it will not have any loops, it's empty. Because it's a different track. Let me show that in the Finder. There we are. And if you look right there, you see, if you look in the where column, you see it's on SSD user, blah, 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 and not on Prutz. That's the reason why this particular Air doesn't have any cues and loops. Now, here's the kicker. If I start up the collection backup tool again, there it is, and I point it to the iTunes Music Library XML, which iTunes automatically creates when I quit it. And if you are on Catalina and Music, you have to manually export that, but it's still doable, it's still usable. I take this one. And we want to go to the Prutz drive, but the collection backup tool already anticipated on that. So I basically say start conversion and we just walk away. This will be very fast because we are talking about the same track. So basically all it needs to do is to restructure the XML so it points to tracks on Prutz. Still with me, folks? Now here comes the real trick. If I go to Recordbox right now, and I tell it to use the iTunes Music Library XML on Prutz. Now, right now it uses the default one in the iTunes collection, but I can say no, you have to use the one on Prutz, which is right here. Then you will see that all of a sudden we still have the same playlist. Everything looks the same, right? But if I now load the Air track, and you can see it already was recognized, it got the cues and loops. And again, folks, this is coming all from the Prutz drive. So the Prutz drive is containing all the information. The moment I quit Prutz or I eject Prutz, all this information will be gone. I can no longer load it, I can no longer use. So it's a temporary solution and not a permanent solution, which is exactly what you want, of course. If I now try to load it, you can also already see the exclamation mark. It will not load it because it doesn't exist anymore. If I want to use in the iTunes part, you can see there is nothing there because the XML is not available because the drive is away. So this is a temporary thing, but now here comes the good part. I can use this in Windows too. And let me start up for that my Windows environment. Hold on, this runs the risk that things get a little slow, but let me double check that for you and see how it goes. I want to have the Windows X system, which is right here. And give it some time to start up, please. There we are. Let me bring my Prutz drive back online, so we know what we are doing. It surely takes its time to start up, doesn't it? No, we don't want that. All right, here we are in Windows, or actually in a Windows environment. And you can see the Prutz drive. Now, the big difference between Windows and macOS is, of course, that macOS uses a drive name as a designation, and Windows uses a drive letter. Now, first, I need to know which drive letter am I going to get if I'm going to mount my IC box to this computer. And you just saw me doing that. And let's see, I'm not a Windows expert, folks, so bear with me here. But let's see what we've got. We've got the E drive. So Prutz is basically the E drive, which is important information for us to know. And that is not a folder. Ah, it shows. All right. That's all fine. Now, I cannot use the XMLs right here. I can see them. You see the iTunes Music Library. You see the Rekordbox XML. Those are useless because they are pointing to a drive with a name and not to the E drive, which my Prutz apparently has. But no fear. I'm going to unmount the IC box right there. And with the Rekordbox Track Backup Tool comes a little app, and it automatically installs it. You don't have to do anything. It's automatically installed in the Rekordbox Track Backup Tool main folder, and that is Convert to Windows Letter. And the moment I start up that app, the only thing I have to do is tell it which letter I want to use. And you and I know it's the E drive, so we want to have the letter E. And what it will do, it will create two new iTunes Music or two new XMLs, the iTunes Music Library for Windows with E in brackets and the Rekordbox Windows with E in brackets. These XMLs are ready to go on a Windows machine, which means if we mount our Windows machine back or mount our drive back, and let's double check that indeed it is on E. There we are. And if I start Rekordbox, why not? So we are in Windows now, folks. This is a Windows environment we are looking at. I go to the preferences and to the advanced, and I'm going to point it to the Rekordbox. Oh, that's fine. I'm moving ahead here, but that's okay. What I already did now is I took the Windows E iTunes, and let me get the Rekordbox one as well, which is right here. Okay. So basically, I got both there. Make sure that everything is on there. iTunes, yeah, that's all fine. So if I go to Rekordbox and I go to the air track, let us find that one. There it is. I load it up. There it is. We got our cues and loops. This is Windows, folks. So you can imagine this is my friend's computer. I took my drive there and I connected it, and now I've got my stuff on Windows. But it's even better. If we look at the iTunes part, and we look at the trends, and we take the all I need from there, it's still got our cues and loops. And you can see that everything else is there as well, but we didn't set any cues there. But you can see that you can load it up and it will be there and it will work. So this makes your entire complete Rekordbox collection and iTunes collection portable. But there is more. There's always more. Why not? If we take that iTunes Music Library Windows E file and just put it on the desktop. There it is. You can see I got Serato installed. I got Engine Prime installed. I got a lot of other stuff installed. Let's focus on Serato. Serato can read iTunes playlists, as we all know. So my friend is not using Rekordbox. He is using iTunes. or Serato. If I go to the music folder right here, inside the iTunes folder right there, and our friend needs to have iTunes installed on his computer. If not, you have to download it for free from Apple and just install it, which is what I did before I moved to this particular demonstration. And there you can see the iTunes music library right here. Let me get that name, because this is important, folks. The iTunes music library, as we all know, is automatically generated the moment we quit iTunes. So it's very safe to replace it with our own iTunes music library XML, because nothing will happen to our friend's iTunes collection. The XML is not the collection, it's just a way of iTunes to communicate with the outside world. And if we are replacing it with our own one, and that means those names must be identical, and it must be in that folder, so I just replaced it, and I fire up Serato. There we go. I hope it's working. I'm not a Windows guy, so I'm not used to having delays when I start stuff, etc. I'm not used to that. But you can already see that right here, we've got our iTunes collection again. And we even got the air track there. And another thing to keep in mind, if I use the DJ conversion utility to give those tracks Serato tags, which means you can convert from Rekordbox to Serato, then put them on that drive, or that collection backup tool put them on that drive, those tracks should have Serato cues. I'm pretty sure that the acapellas will have this, so let's take a look inside the acapellas. And usually the Super Hill Gang Rapper's Delight is always a very safe bet, so let's see there. You can see indeed. This is still coming from my Prutz drive, folks. This is my Prutz drive. This is not something I already prepared in Record or in Serato before I moved on. No, this is the Prutz drive. Let me show that to you. If we take away the Prutz drive, and let me unmount that again. Like this. And fire up Serato again. So you can see this is powerful stuff, because with a very simple drive I can have everything there. You can see that, of course, it will still find my playlist because I didn't restart iTunes, but you can see the playlists are empty because the tracks are no longer there. They cannot be found because the Prutz drive is no longer mounted. I'm not sure if Serato is very intelligent about this. Let's see what happens. Always a nice... There we are. Library update is complete, but it doesn't refresh it. I think I have to manually refresh it then in order to make that happen. But if we restart Serato, then it's always working. So this is really powerful. You have one drive, and that basically covers everything, because you can do exactly the same thing in Virtual DJ and in Traktor as well. So this drive does not only service Rekordbox or iTunes, it basically services every app that can use iTunes data if you just simply know which drive letter it gets. And if you want to have other drive letters generated, you can just generate them on the spot as you like. You can see if the drive is back, the playlists are available again, or the tracks are available again. So that is how the iTunes Rekordbox collection backup tool can make your life a whole lot easier. And this also is for the drives you create for the Denon Prime ecosystem, because I can easily turn this Prutz drive into a Denon capable drive, which can be connected straight to my SC5000 players, will work in Engine Prime, Windows, and Macintosh, the like. Let us do that, because why not? I'm not going to do it for the entire drive, I'm just going to do the trans collection, because that works the fastest. So let's fire up the Denon conversion utility here. and it automatically goes to the Prutz drive for the iTunes file, because that was the last generated XML file, and it is intelligent about that, so it anticipated on that. Let's start the conversion here, disable the protection. And we need to have the trans thing. There is one slight problem with this right now, and that is that the Rekordbox collection doesn't have any playlists, and the Denon conversion utility lives by the fact that you can use a playlist, that it has a playlist, and it doesn't have a playlist. However, we have a solution for that. First of all, you see here the trans crate created. Because the tracks are completely new to Engine Prime, this drive was freshly formatted. It also made a special crate with the tracks that needs to be analyzed, because they were not analyzed. You can do that right now. I will do that later on. Because I'm quitting Engine Prime here, I'm starting up the Denon conversion utility. And I'm not going to pick the Rekordbox XML, but I'm going to pick something else that you might have seen in the Rekordbox track backup tool. And that is the RTB sync XML. And that particular XML is what usually is used when the Denon conversion utility automatically invoked. You don't need to have playlists. You can just select that one because it will have a playlist. And it created that playlist for us, because there were tracks copied. And let's see what's going to happen here. It might be, it doesn't have any playlist. All right, then we abort it. There we are.
The Denon conversion utility needs your attention.
And this is for the mandatory analyzation, as always in Rekordbox. And mind you, this is mid-procedure, folks. This is in the midst of the Denon conversion utility procedure. I want to have them all. I don't want one. Though I could suffice by only taking the air track, because that's the only one with real information. But let's do it like this. In the meantime, are there any questions? There is one question I hear. Let me take a look at the question while Engine Prime is working here. Eddie is asking a question about, I'm not completely clear. In iTunes on my Mac, I have a track that I can play using the Finder, but not in iTunes. Might be several things at work there. It might be that it's a FLAC track, and FLACs can be played from the Finder if you've got a FLAC encoder installed. But if you don't have, but iTunes doesn't work with FLAC, so most likely it's a FLAC track. But there can be several things at work, Eddie, for that to happen. J.W. Groeneweg asked me, which USB drive do you advise? Basically, it depends on what you're doing. SanDisk Extremes are my go-to drive for everything under 64 gigabyte. Let me show that to you. Let me get them from here. That's one. And we got an Extreme Go. All right. In the meantime, this is finished. Let me finish this first and then go to the USB. That keeps things a little bit more easy to follow. If we now go, and let me do that from the, I can of course find it from here, but let me do that from the trans track, and if we go to the air track, then you see the beat marker was found, the cue was found, and our loop is set. Mind you, this is in Mac OS. But we have the same in Windows if I mount the IC box here. And this is still that same drive that also has the iTunes information and the record box information on it. So this is a multi-purpose drive. You can basically do anything you want with this. If I fire up Engine Prime, this is Windows this time around. We are in Windows. And we go inside the playlists. And we go to Air. And we load it up. And yay, lo and behold, everything is there. So this drive does not only work on my SC5000 straight away. It also works in Engine Prime Windows, including everything else. I'm going to quit Windows here, and then I'm going to answer JW Groeneweg's question about USBs. This is my favorite one to use, SanDisk Extreme, very, very fast. These 500 gigs is what I like to use on a Nexus 2 rig. Nexus 2 can read everything you throw at it, but other CDJs are not as compatible. So that's why this is reserved for my Nexus 2 rig. These ones, especially if you stay below 32 gigabyte, and if you format them FAT, MBR, will play on anything. There is a tutorial in my YouTube channel talking about how you can create CDJ USBs from Racketbox. The easy way is basically the sync manager, as I showed with iTunes, but then this time around with a Racketbox collection to a USB device. And there are some other things you might want to know. There are more questions. Oh, it's IFF. All right, Eddie, then you must, there is something, there exists something that is called IEFF-C, and that is not IEFF lossless, as we all think it is. No, the C stands for compressed. And IEFF-C gives a lot of compatibility problems. I've seen IEFF-Cs not working in Serato. I've seen them not working in iTunes, but working in the Finder. So I think it's an IEFF-C file you are talking about, and that you want to convert that to something else. The easiest way to convert the track is, let me see if I have that on my system. I should have it because, oh, there it is. It's this little program called XLD. It's freeware. You basically start it up. You tell it what kind of conversions you want to do. So this is my default lame MP3, and then I want it to be a constant bit rate, highest quality there, a stereo 44. These are just basic best quality MP3s that comes down to. And if you throw a track on it, so if you can find it in the Finder, you know where the track is, so you can drag it. And you go to the music, and let's find, I have some multi-format tracks somewhere, if I'm not mistaken. Let me see where I hide them. Not here, as far as I see. All right, well, then it still works the same. You just take a track, drop it on XLD, and it will convert it for you at the same location as it is right now, as you can see. And it also keeps all your metadata, if there is metadata in it, that it can read, so artwork, etc., it will keep that. And you can see right here, this is the one that was created by XLD. So that is one of the things that is very useful. Let me make sure that my virtual environment is closed, otherwise it will eat up through all my CPU cycles. Next up is... there is another question. Let's see what other question we got. Yes, in the house. Do you format all drives XFAT? Depends, Jesse. As soon as I have something to do with Denon Prime, then I format them XFAT. If I'm only going to Windows and I'm not talking about CDJ usage, I go XFAT. CDJ don't read XFAT. So that's why you need to go to FAT. And FAT still has the limitation of a 4 GB file. And 4 GB audio files are rare to be found, that's correct. But for instance, the collection databases of Engine Prime can easily grow out of 4 GB. For instance, I just showed yesterday in my workflow video that my databases in Engine Prime are 16 GB, I think, and 5 GB or something. So huge files. And if that happens on a FAT drive, it will corrupt and it won't work anymore. So that's the reason why I stick to XFAT wherever I can, unless I'm sure I go to CDJs. For instance, this little one is formatted FAT. And if I'm using CDJ USBs, SanDisk, FAT, MBR, all the way. But for everything else, XFAT to stay compatible with everything. HFS, Mac OS Extended, as it's called these days, is of course within a Mac OS environment ideal. It also works on some Nexus players, but again, that's always tricky, so I rather stick with FAT there. But that is way faster, because everything that happens on a Mac OS Extended or APFS drive is faster than when you need the translation to FAT or XFAT, so keep that in mind. All right. Back to Mario's question, and Mario had Mario is like me, a tractor user. He basically uses a lot of my tools as well. And Mario had two questions. First of all, can I show how you can get information from tractor and iTunes combined on the same drive? And his second question was, why are all my queues purple in Engine Prime, and why don't they have unique colors? And those things are intertwined. I'm going to work with the iTunes collection I already got on the Prutz drive. So basically the Prutz drive remains the drive I'm going to work on. And let's fire up Tractor here. There we are. You can see no playlist there, but there is a lot of tracks there. And let me double check if these tracks have been processed by the Tractor Queue and Key tool. If not, we are going to do that. Or actually, I can do that right away. Let me find the air track, because the air track was our new focus track. No, they are not queued. And you can see in the air track, there is a beat mark position there, and that's all the information there is. Which means what I want to do is I want to have this information. I want these tracks to have automatic cues generated by the Tractor Queue and Key tool, or actually Mixed in Key. And for that, it is just quitting Tractor here. I already had them in Mixed in Key, so what I'm quickly going to do is just give them the cues from Mixed in Key, and then I can pick it up from there. Go ahead, do your thing. Will be quick enough, as you can see. And if we load up the air track right now, we will see that, lo and behold, come on, it has some cues there. I remember there were some, Age of Love is more interesting, because you can see it has a loop. And that loop was not overwritten by the Tractor Queue and Key tool, because it maintains everything you set yourself, user set queues and loops in Tractor, and then add Mixed in Key queues where it can. And that's why it is so important to do it like this. Let's keep that as our focus track, the Age of Love by Age of Love. And you will see in a moment why I want to have that as a focus track. I'm going to use a trick here, because as you can see, this particular Tractor collection doesn't have any playlist. Well, it has now, because it processed some tracks with the Tractor Queue and Key tool, but usually it doesn't have any playlist, because everything it does lives under the iTunes tab right here. And there we've got our demo tracks again. And there you see all the stuff that is there. And you can load from there. Let's see. I hope I didn't move that too much, but let's see what's happening there if it loads at the top. Now it takes from a different location. All right, no problem there. We're going to continue with this. Basically, I want to know where it's loading from. Let me find out where it's loading for, so I'm getting a consistent story about everything there. It's loading them from the demo tracks, that's correct. And then the question remains, where is the other one coming from? Oh, there are two versions there. That's not what I want. So there you can see you can mess this stuff up pretty easily and pretty quickly, folks. Let me look in the file path what I'm looking at. That's the demo. All right, the file paths are different. All right, this is going to be a problem. So let me see if I can fix this quickly. Most likely not, which means I'm going to empty the track collection. And I'm basically going to do the same thing I did with Recordbox, namely just loading up a track. And let's see what I've got. Ah, that got something in it. Why not? And let's take the Apollo track. Why not? The Apollo track has something in it. Those cues are not what I want them to be. And what do I have there? Nothing there. Okay. Let's stick to the Apollo track. And I'm going to clean it up a little bit. I'm going to empty those cues there. And let me do that with my player link, because I can do that much faster on a controller than something else. Like this. And we got an intro and outro loop. That's fine for me. Let's see in the track collection. Those two I want to remove to be sure that I'm not messing around here. We've got all I need right there. So basically, this is coming from my iTunes collection, and that's why I was a little bit working on it. I want to make sure that indeed I'm loading these from my iTunes collection, and these are not processed by MixedInKey. So let's throw them in MixedInKey, have them processed, and work that way around. Like this. Quick tractor there. Because I need those MixedInKey cues to show Mario exactly what is going wrong in his workflow and how he can fix it. So that's why I'm a little bit eager to get those that information in. Go ahead, do your thing. Nope. Alrighty. Let me load that up. Now, if you look, and that was the reason why I wanted to do this again, at the name, you see that there is a queue name there, TCK, Q4, Q8, and between brackets, you see the energy level of the moment segment the queue points to. And right here, you've got loops, like we already had there. This is important, folks. The queues have a name, loops don't have a name. And I'm going to export the collection to an NML, which is your basic DJ conversion utility procedure. As you might be aware, of course, these tracks are in a playlist right now, but I'm not going to use a playlist. I'm going to use the modification date. And what does that mean? That means that the DJ conversion utility will basically take every track you played with after or at a given date. And to make things easy, we use the date of today. And only those tracks are converted. But that means you don't have a playlist where they are part of, because you worked from a modification date. Now the beauty of this is that these two things intertwine. Like one track can be part of multiple playlists. It can also be part of multiple DJ software, as we saw earlier in the stream when I created the Prutz drive and showed you on Serato, etc., how that works. Now, if you look right here, you see it has two tracks. I don't care about this, I just can import it straight away. But if I look in the iTunes tab, and I look in the trans track, trans, right there, and if we load the Apollo track, let me find that, there it is. You can already see that it's there, and you can see it has blue cues. And those blue cues are purple in the instance of Mario. And let me show you why they are purple. And the top secret sauce there is called the cue and loop parameter settings application. And that is something that comes with every of my tools. And what it does is it takes the name of a cue and assigns a color and a full name to it. You can use it to abbreviate cue names and to ultimately give them colors. But in Mario's instance, TCK was purple, which is by default the TCK color I install. Why is that? It's an homage to Prince, and it just makes it very easy to recognize as a call or as a cue coming from the Traktor Cue and Key Tool, so basically a mixed in key cue. So it's very easy to identify it. Let me do that again. And you saw that I just changed the color in the app. I could also take it away. I could also give it another different abbreviation. That doesn't matter. There we are. And I have, of course, close it up to import the information again. That's fine. And I go to the iTunes part. I could pick it from the normal part, but since we are working on it, and now you can see they are purple. So that's what's happening there, Mario. You are looking at TCK cues, you are looking at mixed in key cues that were converted to Traktor. They've got TCK in the name, and they will turn purple by default, like the loops are green. Now, here comes the kicker. If you don't use Rekordbox at all, I used it just to show you the difference in colors if you use the cue loop parameter settings. But if you don't use Rekordbox at all and you want to go straight to the Denon drive, so you use the collection backup tool right here, and it will anticipate for us again. And it will say, all right, I used the DGCU XML, which was just produced to the Prutz drive. We start up the procedure. And this will be very fast because there are only two tracks there. So this is very quickly. But again, it's about how will this work on the complete system. There we are. Let's find out, where am I? As you might notice, there is no analysis required because we already analyzed those tracks. So those tracks are already analyzed, and analysis is only required once. So that's the beauty of that. And here you can see the purple cues again, and you can see the green loops, which is from Traktor. Now, if you don't like those purple cues, personally, I find them very valuable because they give me an immediate distinction. All right, those are TCK cues, so maybe I want to ignore them. Maybe they are not good because I didn't set them myself. They were automatically set. But if you want to have distinct colors between the cues, there's a little trick you can do. And that goes very... I didn't want to start rec. My bad. I start Denon Conversion Utility again, and you can see how smart this stuff is, because it will anticipate again, and it will this time use the Rekordbox XML on the Prutz drive, which is the two tracks. Now, if you go to the conversion settings, you can tell that the queue and loop color assignment must be just fixed unique for each queue. So by enabling it like this, we are good to go. We take the protection off, otherwise it will warn us if I don't take it off manually, but now it will just move ahead for us. This is what we want to do. And again, there is no analysis required. We already analyzed those tracks, so that's all good to go. We dive into the transcrate. Let's make this a little bit better so you can see what we are doing. And I take up the Apollo track, was kind of. And now you can see they have unique colors instead of all purple. And that's a fixed assessment of color ranges. You can see the same thing in the loop settings. You see the first one is yellow, last one is kind of blue. There is no last queue there, but this is fixed set. So now your queues have unique colors. It's not something I recommend because it doesn't make a distinction between what's done by the queue and key tool and what's done manually, but you can do it like this if you want to. All right, so that's about Mario G's questions, and I'm thinking that I've got all the questions I had on my list for this particular stream. I'm going to ask if there are no other questions, so that means I'm very clear this time around. That's nice. Don't forget to like and subscribe to my channel, not because I collect likes, but just to show support for my tools. I'm not interested in monetizing my tools. You will not see commercials in my YouTube channel, but it is important for me to show others in the industry that this is serious stuff and that this is used. I've got, of course, my sales figures and I've got my user base to prove it, but it's easier to prove if it can be shown on social media. So that's why those likes, etc., are important. Don't forget to leave your questions for next week's AMA in the comment section of this particular stream, and I will get to them right away next week. June 2nd, mark your calendar. We've got Jeroen Groenendijk of Pioneer DJ over. If you make a comment, you also automatically have a chance to win the famous ATGR cup coasters sent all over the world. It doesn't matter where you live, I just post them. So you have a chance if you leave either a question or a comment, simply leaving a like. I like the likes, I need the likes, as I just explained, but there is no name with the like, so I cannot give them away to likes. You need to leave a comment and or a question, of course. That was it for this week. I hope you enjoyed this stream. Mixmaster G signing off.